It's quite a big topic, this. So I'm going to be touching on a number of different areas, but really just touching on some of the key things. And I've made a couple of assumptions, hopefully they're reasonable, that everyone here believes that ADHD is a real thing. I don't have to sort of convince people that actually it's a established condition, that it's research, lots of literature proving that ADHD exists, and that everyone has the sort of understanding that ADHD is a neurodevelopmental disorder, that, you know, most people are born with ADHD. There's only a few who perhaps through other problems in sort of brain injury and things like that might acquire it, but the vast majority, it's something that you're born with. So I'm going to run through sort of what we call neurotypical adolescent development, so what it is going on inside the brain of a teenager who doesn't have ADHD, and then just talk about the differences between a sort of a teenager who doesn't have ADHD, comparing that with a teenager who does have ADHD. And then I'm going to go through a number of very specific conditions with emotions. So the things that we would perhaps worry about in CAMHS when emotions get to the point where they might be a bit more concerning. So covering things like depression, anxiety, we'll have a break and then come back to post-traumatic stress disorder and adjustment reactions. Adjustment reactions basically being you come across a life event, whatever it might be, but your reaction to it is quite extreme. But it's sort of short and time limited. And then just a small piece on actually what can be helpful in all of those sort of emotional situations. And then go on to the idea about relationships, again, normal adolescent relationships, how ADHD might be different. So it's quite a lot to cover. So I'm not going to be talking about things going on inside the brain in any great detail, and I'm not going to be talking about specific treatments in any great detail, but hopefully just really to give an overview of this sort of the range of issues here. So thinking about what goes on in a teenager's brain, so if you think about sort of normal child development, you have a child who's toddling around, doing the things that children do, and then magically they become an adult like those of us sitting around this table. And it's not a switch that suddenly they become an adult. There's a sort of a graduated period where they become more and more adult-like as they go through adolescence. We used to think, genuinely, don't know how we thought this, but we actually genuinely thought that all brain development finished in early childhood, and once you'd reach early childhood, 4 or 5, that's it, brain didn't develop anymore, and you have the brain that you're going to have when you're an adult. Very clearly, that is not the case, and we're able now to see, with all sorts of scans, we can actually see what goes on inside someone's brain as they're growing older and as they're developing. So, quick anatomy lesson. So this pink bit here is obviously the brain. Inside the brain, you've got some key areas which are really important in terms of ADHD, but also in terms of emotions. So we've got here the amygdala, which is basically the emotional center of the brain, and that's the bit that really guides our emotions, our impulses, aggression, fight, flight, our instincts. So it's a real kind of early bit of the brain that has a lot of our drives. The front bit of our brain, particularly here, the bit just before the front, what's known as the prefrontal cortex, is the bit that helps us to think things through. It's the bit that helps us to kind of coordinate, to have control, to plan ahead, to anticipate, to think about what it's like being in someone else's shoes, all of those things, which are much more the sort of the cooler bit of the brain, the sort of the thinking part of the brain, is more towards the front. And what we know is that when children go through adolescence, the brain suddenly becomes much more complicated. So the brain goes through this rapid growth spurt. And probably the best analogy, it's like when your garden's going through a really dry summer. And it looks very nice, does the job. But suddenly when there's rain, everything blossoms and everything grows. All your bushes get much bigger, your trees put out new leaves. Many more flowers around. The garden looks great, it's incredibly lush, there's lots going on, but there's no structure, there's no organisation. There's a lot going on, but it's not necessarily organised in the best way. And so what we all do, those of us who have gardens, is we go out with the secateurs and we go around and we prune. So we chop off bits to make it look better, we chop off bits so it's easier to get through, we create paths, we create some sense of order to this garden that's grown suddenly twice the size that it was. And that's exactly what goes through adolescence. You have this big proliferation, this growth of the brain, and then your brain prunes and makes your brain much more organized, creates pathways, so things become better connected. And that's really the job that's happening in adolescence. Problem is, in adolescence, even without ADHD, they do it back to front. So the pruning starts pretty much in the middle and works its way to the front. So their emotional centers become much more mature way before the thinking part of the brain starts kicking in. So you get this phase during adolescence where everything is really emotionally led. So if it feels like a good idea, then it is a good idea. And they don't necessarily, it's 3 or 4 years later that the bit kicks in, which says it might feel like a good idea, but I might freak out my parents if I do it. So that's the bit that kicks in about 3 or 4 years later, and that's the thinking, the cooler part of the brain that helps the plan. So that's what goes on in normal adolescence without any other issues, without ADHD. So for an adolescent without ADHD, I mean, you know, you're all going to remember your adolescence, you're all going to remember your teenage years. We've all gone through it, and we can remember what we put our parents through. You know, often it's quite common for young people in their teenage years to go through periods when they are much more moody. They're much more aware of their emotions feel much more intense. First love is there and it's really visceral and important. Much more impulsive, again, because the sort of the impulse center of the brain is matured far way ahead of the planning and organizing part of the brain, so much more impulsive. They're rebellious. We all did this. You know, parents will tell you something, you automatically think you know best, and you do things because you think you know best. And that's an important stage of adolescence because it's how we all help to learn to be independent. We test things out. We figure out what's right for us and become more independent through doing that testing. Through adolescence, you start to learn how to soothe yourself. When you're a younger child, you rely quite often on your parents, your carers, to help to soothe you. As you get older, you develop the ability to soothe yourself. You do develop the ability to hold back on your urges, which might feel like a good idea at the time, but you start to develop the idea that maybe I need to think about this. And that's also linked to self-motivation. Motivation is quite a complex task that you have to be able to think ahead in the future to overcome the impulses of now. So we might think doing our tax returns might be a really good idea, and we've got the end goal, which is not to be so stressed in April, but there's a really good series on TV now. So the motivation, you know, you have to sort of channel some of that anticipated emotion to help push yourself through. And you develop that through adolescence. Bearing in mind what we've talked about with adolescence, that sort of difference between the sort of the center emotional part of the brain and the front thinking part of the brain, that connection is always slightly weaker in kids with ADHD. There's lots of different parts of the brain we know are implicated with ADHD, but that's one pathway that isn't so strong. And so ADHD brains have differences on top of what is going on in adolescence. So, whereas a kid without ADHD would be moody, with ADHD you can notice much more dramatic mood shifts. So you can get, you know, feeling quite happy 1 minute, sitting there doing their own thing, you ask them to do something, and rather than this kind of, you know, exaggerated tut and a moan, oh mum, you're always nagging, it becomes quite an extreme reaction. So we describe that as being labile. So the word labile just means quite noticeable and quite extreme mood swings. They can be really, really happy, really, really down, really, really angry, and it's quite changeable. Whereas in, you know, adolescence, when you have adolescence with ADHD, it moves from just intense emotion to quite extreme emotion. So you might just be really peed off with your parents and go up and slam the door. If you've got ADHD, you're up slamming the door, knocking down all the furniture, punching holes in the wall. It becomes much more exaggerated and extreme. Adolescents with ADHD are impulsive. Like I said, if it feels good, it probably is a good thing to do. Don't think about the consequences. ADHD, that's much more noticeable, that impulsivity. The rebelliousness, which is part of normal adolescence, in ADHD often becomes oppositional. So whereas, you know, in adolescence you tut because parents are telling you their experience, and you're sitting there in your head saying, oh, they don't know anything, they don't know my life, and you go off and do your own thing. With ADHD, they're often too disorganised to do the independence bit. They're too disorganised sometimes to go off and do their own thing, but they're quite up for doing that rebellious bit. And so sometimes it can become much more oppositional without necessarily leaving the house and doing their own thing. So whereas an average teenager who's going through that stage of rebellion will argue with their parents and then storm off and go and spend the evening out with their mates and come back, someone with ADHD might, in certain situations, get very cross and angry with the parents, but then stick at home and be angry at home and not doing the going out bit because they're just too disorganised to do that. Young people with ADHD do struggle to self-soothe. That's something they find harder to learn or to develop. They find it harder to inhibit their urges. So whereas in most adolescents you go through that phase in later adolescence where the front bit of your brain is kicking in and you're able to think about the fact that you are freaking out your parents, or you're able to think about the fact that it might not be a good idea to do whatever. With ADHD, that comes in much, much later. And the motivation, again, is much harder for young people with ADHD because it's such a complicated task. For them to be able to anticipate in the future and think ahead is something that is really, really a challenge for people with ADHD. So the motivation is much more difficult for them to self-motivate. Because if you just sort of take a minute to think about what we're talking about here, we're talking about adolescence, which is a tricky time for anyone. There's a lot going on, not just all the stuff that's going on inside your head. You're figuring out your identity, who you are, you're thinking about what you want to do for the future, there's relationships, so you're becoming much more aware of your sexuality, your physicality, your body is changing, you've got all the hormonal changes going up. You've also got quite significant and important tests going on at school that schools really push at the moment, that you have to succeed, and if you don't succeed in these tests then you can't progress into your future. There's all sorts of things going on with your peer group because all your peers are going through the same things that you are, so things can become quite up and down in your peer group. There's a lot going on at the same time as all these changes going on in your head. So that's for any teenager. And then if you think about a young person with ADHD who sometimes, unfortunately, has gone through school or even in family life being told that they're not behaving, they're not being good enough, that they're not the same as other children, that they're a problem. So they can go into adolescence with their self-esteem not being great. Then you add in all these emotional changes, all these hormonal changes, and all these brain changes. It can be a really tough time for young people with ADHD going through adolescence. So we do see young people presenting with depression. So with depression, what we look for, and this is without ADHD, we're looking for young people who are sad the majority of the time. So they're tearful, they're sad, they're low, they're just unhappy, but it seems to be much more persistent. We have what's called biological features, because depression is something that affects you physically, and you can present with low energy, your appetite goes, it's very difficult to get to sleep, you don't enjoy the things you would normally do, you can become much more irritable. That's something you see much more with teenagers, that irritability. You don't see it so much with adult depression, but with adolescents and teenagers, the irritability is really quite noticeable. They will often feel worthless, useless, have quite low self-esteem. Their thoughts for the future become very negative, and they can't sometimes even see a future. Things get so bleak and so hopeless. And that can lead on to some suicidal thoughts, that actually life is too difficult, and those suicidal thoughts can be something that can be quite worrying. If you compare with ADHD how that can be different, so this is ADHD without depression. So the box on the top left, depression without ADHD, top right, ADHD without depression. Underneath, what happens when you have both? So with depression, you're looking at low mood the majority of time. With ADHD, without depression, they will present with quite significant low moods, and to the point where you can be really worried that they might be depressed, or they might have these sort of suicidal thoughts or statements that they make. But the moods tend to be transient, they tend to be temporary and very much situational. So it's something has kicked it off. They then go through, and it's part of these sort of quite rapid mood changes that we were talking about. So that's not necessarily the same as depression. It's often part of ADHD in this kind of volatility of their emotions. They can be really extreme. Concentration loss in depression is much more related to the onset of depression. So young people would be concentrating at their normal level before the depression, hit the depression, concentration tails off. With ADHD, obviously, we're looking at concentration being a long-term thing, really sort of from early years on. With depression, quite often people will say they're irritable, but the irritability is not their normal self, and they recognise that, and the parents recognise that. But often in ADHD, young people can be very irritable, even without depression. That's, again, part of their character, part of who they are, often part of the ADHD. With depression, the difficulty with sleeping is they can't sleep because their thoughts are so negative. They worry about their thoughts, they're thinking about the worries that they've got for the future, they're stressing about all the things they've got to do the next day. They might be rehashing all the difficulties they've had that same day. With ADHD, they often can't sleep. And again, often this is a long-standing thing, but can't sleep because they can't settle. They're either too active, their mind's too active. They just can't calm down enough to sleep. So there are, although ADHD without depression can look as though there are sort of depressive features or even sometimes look as though it is depression, there are some differences that we look for. When you have the two together, that is tough, and it's tough for the young person with ADHD. What you would notice is there's a change in behaviour, and that's often one of the things that is really quite noticeable with ADHD and depression, that they will no longer enjoy the things that they used to do, so their interests will change. They might not enjoy sports or be as outgoing as they were before, might not want to go out as much. But equally, you can have young people with depression who go out much more. You know, particularly if they want to get out of the house or if they want to avoid school or homework, you might notice that they're sort of running away or they're sort of rushing out of the house and trying to avoid situations. But it's that change in behaviour, that change in personality is sometimes what you're looking for. The moods can be more extreme. So again, whereas ADHD, you get the kind of the ups and downs of the moods, with depression, you will see many, many more low phases, and the low phases seem to become much more the norm. Whereas without depression, you get this sort of, you know, happy times, normal times, sad times in situations, but with depression, it's not so situational. It's just a fairly constant periods of low mood. But at the same time, those moods can still be quite extreme. You notice definitely an increase in impulsivity. Clinically, you seem to notice that a little bit more with boys, that their normal impulsivity in ADHD becomes much more extreme. So we often talk about the fight or flight response when you're stressed, and that when you've got ADHD as well, the fights actually, it's not just I'm cross and I want to have an argument. Those fights can become really quite serious and quite significant and real fights. But it can also lead to self-harm and overdoses because of that impulsivity. If you've got a young person who's really struggling with the suicidal thoughts, add that to ADHD and the impulsivity. Because the impulsivity, and even if the moods are sort of fairly fleeting, a fleeting low mood plus impulsivity, they can still do something that's quite significant to hurt themselves in that brief moment. So certainly if you've got concerns with young people with ADHD around their mood, one other thing I really like to kind of advise people is to make sure that your medication is in a place that's safe and only adults can access. I think sometimes with ADHD, you're so used to having medication because they've been on it since, you know, early years or whatever, so medication becomes part of the house routine. And that's usually fine when they're young kids, but sometimes going through adolescence with all the ups and downs and the extreme mood swings, sometimes when you're in that dark space and you see the tablet of medication on the kitchen counter, it's so tempting to use that. Even if you would regret it afterwards, it's something that's there in that impulsive, very brief moment when they can't see a way out. So sort of that impulsivity is quite important to pick up on. With girls with ADHD, we actually seem to quite often see much more withdrawal. So they might isolate themselves, go out less, avoid doing the things they would normally do, and go much more inward. obviously, to a certain degree, we're talking stereotypes here. So boys being much more outgoing with ADHD, girls being much more distracted and ingoing. But clinically, you do see that difference, but not with everyone. So equally, we might see boys who are much more withdrawn and girls who are much more outgoing. And with depression, girls who are much more acting out and fighting and self-harm, and boys who become much more isolated. So it's not fixed, but there are sort of general differences that you can see. So with anxiety, some similarities, but also some differences. And we'll all know what it's like to feel anxious, because anxiety is just part of the normal human condition. You know, there'll be times we're presenting at work, or there'll be times where we've got a deadline and we will feel anxious about it. You know, the anxiety system is hardwired in all of us. When it becomes a problem, when it becomes a disorder, you feel anxious all of the time, not just when you've got your deadlines. You again get the physical symptoms, so often you'll notice your heart rate going fast, your breathing will increase, feeling sick, dry mouth and shaky. So those sort of feelings of panic can be quite noticeable during anxiety. And you have the classic, the fight, flight or freeze response. So adrenaline levels are high, stress hormones are high, you're feeling very, very anxious, and young people will become very irritable, want to fight, want to argue. They might want to avoid things and run away from a situation, so avoid going to the thing that makes them scared. So might want to avoid going to school, might want to avoid going out to parties, avoid whatever the triggers might be, or freeze. They just literally get paralyzed, can't think, can't do anything, just kind of go in on themselves and everything kind of shuts down. So that fight, flight, freeze response is such a normal part of what we would see in anxiety. And one of the big things that we notice is a lot of avoidance. Kind of goes without saying, really. You know, if you're really anxious about spiders, you're not going to go to London Zoo to see the spider exhibit. You kind of want to avoid those kind of things. If you see a spider and you're really anxious about spiders and you see a spider in your house, you're likely to leave the room and find someone who can go and sort it out for you. So that avoidance is kind of a normal, almost automatic response to anxiety. Problem is, it keeps the anxiety going, because you never confront your fears, you never then overcome your fears. So the next time you see the spider, your brain is still thinking that's something really scary, because you've not had the experience of mastering it. So that's how anxiety is maintained as well. And we see that a lot with young people who get into this habit, particularly of school refusing because they're anxious. They never quite get into school, so the next day they try to go to school. Their anxiety is a little bit bigger because they've not overcome it, so they don't go back into school that day. So that means the day after, the anxiety is still high, they can't get back into school. So you sort of maintain that sort of cycle of anxiety through avoiding it. And it's not necessarily that you should immediately confront all your anxieties or your fears, because that can be overwhelming if you're pushing too fast. And if you feel overwhelmed, that can worsen the anxiety. But to do that in a graded response with a lot of support is a good way of overcoming it. So with anxiety, you get a lot of restlessness. You're nervous. So you've got a lot of nervous energy a lot of the time. You'll often see kind of anxious kids tapping, fiddling, because they get really anxious. Again, you might not have seen that before they were anxious. They don't have a history of it, but it starts when they're anxious, and when they're better, that fades away. Whereas compare that to ADHD, they'll often be restless and hyperactive and fidgety as part of their long-term condition. Same thing with concentration. If you're anxious, it's really hard to focus on something. Now, if you think about the last time you were really anxious about something, and when you sat down and tried to watch a film to take your mind off it, it's really hard to follow the plot, really hard to remember what was on, because your brain is just thinking about what you're worrying about. So you lose your concentration when you're anxious, but again, it's limited to the time when you're anxious. Whereas with ADHD, obviously, inattention, concentration problems are longer term. Anxiety, for a lot of people, again, they might get that irritability, that fight, flight response just increases that irritability. So, you know, you have a bad day at work, your boss is kind of on your neck because you've got a presentation to do, you come home and you take it out on your family, and you're just really irritable and snappy with everyone because you're stressed. Would be potentially seen as out of character quite often. So it's really limited again to the stress, the anxiety at the time. With ADHD, that's not always the case. And I'm not saying that every young person with ADHD is irritable, but certainly as a group, they probably are more irritable than average children without ADHD. And again, that's partly because of their quite extreme swings of mood. So they can get quite frustrated and quite angry much quicker, but can also calm down and be the sweetest kids ever. So it's not necessarily that every kid is irritable, but you do see more of that with ADHD. But it's not limited to a period of anxiety or stress. With anxiety, they can't sleep because they're worried about what they've got to do the next day, or worried about what they've done that same day, worried about something that's happened. Again, with ADHD, just can't settle. When you've got ADHD, sorry, that's meant to say with anxiety, again, you get the changes in behaviour, and that's probably the easiest thing to spot. The avoidance of what makes them scared can be quite extreme. So if you have a young person with ADHD and they are anxious about going into school, whereas a lot of kids will be, you know, I've got tummy ache, I've got headache, I don't want to go into school, they'll do their best to get out of it. A kid with ADHD, actually, things can really escalate if you try and push them to do the thing that they're really scared about, and things can really kick off because, again, they've got that extreme variability of mood and everything is much more intense. The fight or flight response in anxiety can be very literal. They can run away because they just want to avoid the situation, and whereas, you know, a lot of kids will run away and they'll go into their bedroom and slam the door. Someone with ADHD might be out of the front door and down the road. Fighting again with that fight or flight response can become very physical. And we see some kids, unfortunately, who get into fights in their community, in the playground, really as a result of their anxiety, but the fights become real fights. They then get into trouble with the police. And then sometimes the police then become a source of anxiety. So every time they see the police, they then get anxious and kick off, and their fight-flight response comes up. And you can get that really unhelpful cycle of anxiety leading to fights, police involvement. When they see the police, they get anxious. And that kind of cycle goes round and round and round. Again, the increased impulsivity, you see that again, sort of, you know, big stereotype, but you do see it. Increased impulsivity with boys, with fighting, inappropriate behaviour, and that sort of withdrawal and avoidance you will see a lot with girls who are very anxious. And again, this avoidance can be really quite extreme, so digging their heels in and you just can't get them out of the house. So, PTSD. It's not something I would normally talk about with adolescents and demotion, but with ADHD there are some specific reasons why that can be helpful. And I'll link that a little bit with attachment disorder, because one of those things that quite often I'll get asked is, what's the difference between attachment disorder and ADHD? Because they can present in very, very, very similar ways. So PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, it's an anxiety disorder that's associated with something traumatic. The significant thing about the trauma is that it would normally be quite an extreme trauma, that you genuinely believe at that time poses a risk to yourself or someone that you love, or loss of limb. You know, they're really quite significant. But saying that, anything out of that category can still cause PTSD because it's how you think about it at the time. So if you have a sort of car accident, which is actually a relatively minor bump, a prang, someone might get out the car and think, oh yeah, that's really annoying, I'm going to be late for work, but not develop any particular worries about it. But if that same relatively minor prang in your head becomes something bigger, oh my goodness, my kids could have died because I might not have buckled their seat properly or whatever, that then becomes inside much more distressing and potentially can lead on to PTSD. With young people, one of the things that we do sometimes see is quite significant bullying can be a trigger for PTSD. Often the bullying is quite extreme, but you can have very chronic bullying going on over long periods of time that just sort of traumatizes you at a slightly lower level. Might not cause PTSD, but still might cause significant anxiety. Often what you get with PTSD is this idea of dissociation. So basically your brain's very clever and it will do its best to protect you. And if you're going through something really scary, sometimes your brain wanders off and goes somewhere else. And it's a way of almost getting out of your head while something very bad is happening to you. And that's what we call dissociation. Once your brain's learnt how to do that, it's quite an easy habit to get into. And so we will see young people with PTSD in the classrooms, their brain goes off somewhere else. And then obviously it affects their concentration. Flashbacks are when you're vividly remembering the traumatic event, and by vivid I mean it's almost like you're back there again, so you're sort of re-experiencing it, and you can see it, you can feel it, you can smell whatever it was that you were experiencing, so it becomes very, very intense. Quite often, particularly young people, they might get recurrent nightmares, they can be very jumpy and easily startled. A lot of association with anxiety and panic, particularly during the flashbacks. And they can be very hyper-aroused. They're almost on this state of high alert. It's like their emergency button's being pressed. And that hyper-arousal can look like hyperactivity because they just can't settle to anything. They're just always on the go, can't really calm themselves down to get on with anything. So that sort of hyper-arousal can look like ADHD. And again, quite often they can't concentrate because their brain is filled with the bad memories or whatever it is that they've been struggling with. So with attachment disorder, where young people will be diagnosed with attachment disorder, it's usually when they've been through something very traumatic very early on in their lives. And again, that trauma, even if it's very early on, can still lead to states of hyper-arousal and potentially with poor concentration, simply because they've been so traumatized. And it affects their ability to form relationships because the people that were meant to be keeping them safe didn't always keep them safe or weren't able to keep them safe. So those young people, again, can often look very hyperactive because they're rushing around and interacting with everyone, but it's more because of their relationships are sort of indiscriminate rather than the fact that they're hyperactive. But it can look quite similar. PTSD and attachment. Again, you get the restlessness, but again, only really since the trauma. So you haven't necessarily had any restlessness before, have something traumatic, you're then restless after. And it's that restlessness is often associated with flashbacks. They might be fine, have a flashback, and then become very hyper-aroused after the flashback. Again, the poor concentration tends to be recent. Irritability is quite prominent, again, really as a result of the trauma and how they're struggling after. Can't sleep. Sometimes they just get very anxious about sleeping because they know when they sleep they're going to have really bad dreams. So that might put them off from going to sleep. With attachments, often you'll find that there's that history of abuse or trauma early on. They find relationships quite difficult. With ADHD, hyperactivity tends to be long-standing, poor concentration is long-standing, irritability. Parents will often say that there's no sudden changes in that, it's something that is part of just, you know, the normal interactions. Can't sleep again because they find it difficult to settle. They can have significant relationship difficulties. Often that tends to be much more because of the impulsivity. They can form relationships and form very good relationships, but those can be affected by the impulsivity. So more arguments, more falling outs, but the ability to form relationships is there. ADHD with PTSD, kids with ADHD are much more at risk of PTSD, and that's partly because they're actually much more at risk of trauma. And that's partly they're at risk of being a victim. They're more likely to put themselves out in situations which can be unsafe. But also, unfortunately, sometimes they can become a perpetrator, particularly if they end up going down the route of sort of criminal behaviour as a result of their impulsivity. And we've had a number of young people who've done something impulsively that they've regretted, but just the very thing that they did then actually traumatizes them, because they don't see it as being part of who they are. They're not kind of hardened criminals. They end up doing something they think, oh my god, why did I do that was so stupid, but they've done it and they then have to live with the consequences, and actually that can be quite traumatic for them. Particularly girls, but actually some boys with ADHD are actually at higher risk of bullying. Again, that can then lead on to traumatic experiences. And again, you'll notice this sort of change in personality. It can go either way, really. It can become, young people with ADHD can become much more withdrawn, much more anxious, lots of anxiety and panic, avoidance, because they don't want to go to anything that reminds them of the trauma. So sometimes that will be a particular place, it might be a particular situation, it might be a group of people that they want to avoid, so they'll do their best to avoid that. And again, the fight or flight can be very little. Same thing with anxiety. And again, that unfortunately can then become re-traumatizing because, you know, if it was something to do with a fight that caused the PTSD in the first place, the fact that they then get hyper-aroused and more likely to fight just means every time they fight, they then get more anxious about it, and that can kind of keep that cycle going. Boys with PTSD, the impulsivity, you often see that again associated with flashbacks. So when they're in the middle of a classroom or they are at home and they're suddenly flooded with a bad memory, level of anxiety goes up, level of arousal goes up, whereas someone without ADHD might be able to talk it through and say, oh my God, I'm seeing whatever I'm seeing and I'm, you know, remembering something. With ADHD, you're much more likely to get someone running upstairs, knocking down furniture. Things, again, emotionally become quite extreme. But they might act on that emotion right there and then rather than be able to sit down and talk about it. And the withdrawal, again, you get, and again, bit of a gender stereotype. With girls with ADHD, you will often see that sort of withdrawal and avoidance more than boys with ADHD. So, just briefly, adjustment reactions. So that is the development of emotional or behavioural symptoms. It can be any of the symptoms we've talked about so far, but in reaction to a specific stressful situation. So life is ticking along quite nicely, thank you very much. Something difficult or unpleasant or bad happens that you find difficult to cope with. You then get a period of anxiety, period of depression, but related to the event that you've just gone through. Can be triggered by breakups, bullying, family difficulties, bad exam results. Pretty much think of any major life event, it can then trigger an adjustment reaction. Key points in the academic year to be aware of for this, because CAMHS has a very clear life cycle that we really notice. New Year's Eve. We see many, many more referrals of adjustment reactions around New Year's Eve. Parties, people, particularly kids with ADHD, a bit impulsive, not necessarily thinking through, making good choices. They might take things that they shouldn't have taken, drunk too much, ended up with, you know, some big event, some sort of crisis that happens, often in a party. Breakups on New Year's Eve, much more common with teenagers and adolescents. Partly as a result of the drink, the intensity of New Year, that whole thing of, do I want to go through another year with someone I'm not so sure about? But the breakups can then become, you know, badly handled sometimes, that can be traumatic. So we definitely see a peak in that in New Year, things settle down. Valentine's Day, we get another peak of adjustment reactions. Again, that whole thing of going into Valentine's Day with someone you're not so sure about, and bad breakups. And again, if you think about the context of what we're talking about, adolescence, where emotions are felt much more intensely, you're going through relationships, figuring out your identity, what works for you, what doesn't work for you. You know, those first relationships are just so important and so intense that that can trigger something like this. And then things settle down until we go through exams, and then again we get another sort of period of crisis during the exams, and then we get another one later on with sort of bad exam results. So we get sort of peaks and troughs during the year, sort of classic events, but obviously this can happen at any time. You know, anyone can have a breakup at any time, anyone can have a bad experience, bullying or whatever it might be at any time. The key thing with adjustment reaction is the distress is more extreme than expected considering the trigger. So, you know, a lot of teenagers manage relationship difficulties absolutely fine and kind of go on with a bit of support from parents and kind of move on to the next or have a break or whatever, and it's okay. Bad exam results, they're able to think about it, they're able to get support from the parents and family, from peers, put it in context, move on. So, when we've been talking about ADHD, with it, emotions being A, much more intense, but also finding it difficult to put things in context, finding it difficult to think about the bigger picture, they can be just much more susceptible to these sort of adjustment reactions. We really expect the adjustment reaction to resolve well within 6 months, and that's really part of the definition. This is a brief but intense period of emotional distress tied to a particular event. Symptoms can be depressive, anxious, change in behaviour. So with ADHD, unfortunately, people with ADHD are more exposed to stressful situations, usually because of their impulsivity. Emotional reactions can be more extreme, and of course, impulsivity, like I said before, increases risk. So again, this is one of those situations where I think it's good practice, really, for rather than medication to be left on the kitchen counter, which we all do when it's part of a life routine, particularly when you're going through sort of the volatility of adolescence, to start thinking about, well, let's just create that extra 5 minutes gap between bad relationship breakup, oh my goodness, life is not worth living, there's the tablets on the kitchen counter. At least if there's that 5 minutes break, they can then bring themselves down, they can then think about it, get support from family, and things are sort of much safer. So we've covered adolescent brains and why adolescents on the whole are generally more impulsive, more emotional, more extremes, and that's just part of normal development. Talk about ADHD in relation to that. And then talk about very specific emotional situations which we might be more worried about. So what can be helpful? The first four are really kind of lifestyle, but so important. Structure and boundaries. Really, that's kind of preventative, because if you think about a lot of the things that we've talked about that can be triggering for anxiety situations, for depression, for PTSD, for adjustment reactions, you know, we're often talking about kind of unexpected events that can be completely out of control. So boundaries, structure, can just reduce the risk of a young person with ADHD getting into those difficult situations in the first place. Regular sleep is incredibly important, but also sometimes a real challenge for ADHD. There's so much research now coming up about teenagers and sleep, partly because teenage patterns have changed over the last 15, 20 years, really because of social media, I think. You know, often now young people are awake 2 or 3 hours before they should be going to bed because they're under the covers and they've got their social media, or they're quite openly doing their social media until 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. And then they're not getting enough sleep, and then they're more irritable and more emotionally vulnerable the next day because they've not had enough sleep. Exercise, really important and useful, partly as a way of, you know, it can improve self-esteem. If you can then become good at something, good at sport, good at exercise, you can then get a sense of mastery in one area of your life that can improve self-esteem, and improve self-esteem is a really good buffer for all of these things that we've talked about. But also, exercise obviously produces your natural endorphins. Often people will feel better after they've exercised. It's a good release of tension. And again, if you're involved in team sports, again, that sense of belonging, that sense of connection can be really helpful. Good nutrition, again, really helpful. So things like avoiding caffeine, particularly if you're going through a stressful or anxious time, cutting down on the caffeine, particularly for kids and young people with ADHD, the kind of the energy drinks, making sure that you're not having too many of those, because too many of those can increase anxiety. And alcohol is a depressant. It's why, you know, a lot of us take it, because it kind of reduces things. It reduces your inhibitions, which is why socially we use alcohol to interact and, you know, mix socially. But it also lowers your mood, that increases depression, can lead to anxiety as well. So worth being aware of that. Problem solving, particularly for kids with ADHD, because the bit the connection between the emotions and the front bit of the brain, which is the bit that helps us to think, to plan, to organise, because that isn't so strong, they will often find it much harder to solve problems. So actually helping them talk it through can be really helpful. And that's really for any teenager as well, but particularly for kids with ADHD. Peer problems are probably one of the biggest triggers for these emotional difficulties. You can pretty much pick any of them: depression, anxiety, PTSD. Difficulties within the peer group is definitely one of the commonest triggers for all of this. So having a way where you can discuss with your teenager, you know, how they're getting on socially, what's going on with the peer group, helping them think about how they would deal with situations differently, that kind of rehearsal, problem solving, thinking things through can be really, really helpful. Building on that sense of achievement and mastery, self-esteem, so things they can do in school, things they can do outside of school, things they can do with family members, You know, if you've got someone in the family who works, can they do part-time work for them? You know, all those kind of things that give them that sense of achievement is helpful. Focusing on what they do well, so the positive praise really is protective for depression and anxiety as well. Because bearing in mind the life experiences of a young person with ADHD can often be quite negative and critical from those around them. If that's all they get, actually, again, that can really increase the risk of depression and anxiety. So some buffer for that can be really helpful. You know, I really liked it when you did that, or, you know, well done. You know, all those kind of positive praises can, again, just help to be a sort of counterbalance for all the stuff they're experiencing outside of home. In education, there can, again, be very specific triggers. We might be looking at bullying, we might be looking at particular lessons, particular subjects that can be a trigger, either for depression or anxiety, so helping to problem solve that. Sometimes it means going to school and meeting up with the teacher or meeting up with the wider system to kind of try and resolve some of those things. And this is more general for adolescents as a whole, not specific to ADHD, but mindful to keep adult problems with the adults. When teenagers, there's always that temptation, because they are that much older and more mature, to start to share with them some of the worries that the adults have got, whether it's about finances or the parental relationship or whatever. But children have always got one foot, well, adolescents have got one foot in childhood, one foot in adulthood. And they might seem more adult because of how they chat to you, talk to you or whatever, but actually emotionally they might not be equipped to deal with the stuff that you as adults are dealing with. And then again, that can then become an additional stress on top of all the other stuff that they're worrying about. And also really useful just to plan a review of the medication if young people with ADHD are on medication. All the stuff we've talked about, there can be interactions with medication. We know that particularly stimulant medication, there are some side effects that just cause that kind of flattening of mood. So that's sort of what we call a dysphoric reaction. So people, that tends to be sort of an off-on thing. So if they've had a break and they go back on the medication, their moods can be lower for the first few days. But for some people are just very sensitive to that. And so just reviewing medication in the context of all the emotions that are going around can sometimes be quite helpful. But also, if they have then gone on to develop a depression or anxiety, we may need to add something in specific in terms of their treatment. So it may be that they might need a period of talking therapy. It might mean that they need a letter from CAMHS to resolve something at school. They might need something else as part of their treatment plan to support them whilst they're going through whatever it is that they're going through. But it kind of links in with the relationships and adolescent relationships. So if you think about, again, the situation that teenagers are in, they've got relationships with lots of different people. But when you're a child, pretty much younger children have a relationship with their family. That's it. And they, as they get older, they then start having relationships with their friends and their teachers at school. As they get older and go into teenage years, they then start having relationships with people outside of school and a sort of wider social group. So that sort of changes and naturally progresses. With teenagers, you get this funny situation where parents, you know, you guys are still supporting them financially and practically, but they are no longer your child. They are now their own person. They've got their own ideas, their own desires, their own wants. Not necessarily the same as yours. So you've got that funny kind of clash sometimes between the reality that actually they are still your child and will always be your child, and they are at home and you're feeding them and clothing them and keeping them warm, but they're independent and wanting to be independent and going out and doing their own thing. And that's a natural and essential part of growing up. If you don't manage that, you get stuck at home for the rest of your life. So that's a really important and normal part of teenage development. So it's normal to move away from parents and to move, you know, from parents being the main relationships to your peers being the main relationships, and that's normal. Normal to start challenging parents' ideas, your values, your beliefs. You know, you may vote for a particular party, they may then start arguing against you because they have different beliefs. It's all part of them developing their own identity and figuring out who they are. And often teenagers go through that phase of, I can only figure out who I am if I push you far enough away, that there's then space between us that I can figure it out. So there's that kind of initial pushing away before they then later on become a bit closer. And that desire to be independent is really there. Then they're not quite ready to be fully independent. They can't pay the mortgage, they can't pay the bills, they can't go shopping, sometimes can't even buy their own clothes. But they don't want to be told what to do because they're their own person. So you get that funny, like I said, one foot in childhood, one foot in the adult world, and that funny hybrid position. Peers, friendships become much more important in terms of validation, so in terms of people being positive about who you are, and again, that helps with your own formation of your own identity. So teenagers will start to confide in their friends and not their parents, whereas you might have been the person they would go to straight away if there is a problem. You are now probably near the bottom of the list between friend 1, 2, 3, and 4 first. And the social world becomes much more focused on peers than parents. And again, that's what you want at some level because you want them to become independent and to move on. Intimate relationships become much more important. There's a huge amount of hormones going on, but it's also linked with identity and who you are. And that desire to have that close, confiding, intimate relationship. So again, all of that is just a normal part of all the changes that happen with teenagers. ADHD relationships, we touched on this before, someone raised the point quite rightly that young people with ADHD actually can be less mature. So the thinking part hasn't kicked in and often will be a little bit later in kicking in than perhaps their peers without ADHD. But even so, their desire to be independent is happening at exactly the same time as their peers. So they might have the same desires and wants and needs to be independent without necessarily having their own ability to be independent. They can't necessarily organise themselves to get to their own parties. You know, it can be that extreme. Impulsive acts can definitely worry parents more, whereas we spoke about before, teenagers are often impulsive, and that's part of just how their brain is wired at that time. Because with ADHD, the impulsivity is much more noticeable. Actually, some of the things they can end up with can be quite worrying and quite risky at times. So there can be more anxiety being a parent of a young person with ADHD. And their normal rebellion, so the normal rebellion as a way of separating from parents, again, can be much more extreme with ADHD because often emotions are more extreme when you have ADHD. So that whole traditional, do you remember the comedy show that Kevin and Perry, that sort of grumpy adolescent, you don't understand me, you know nothing, all that kind of thing.
I started
being
like that since
he
was 3.
Okay, there you go. So that kind of normal teenage rebellion can then just become much more pronounced and much more confrontational sometimes, because again, they've got that impulsivity, but without the ability easily to think things through about what it's like to be in your shoes, which teenagers on the whole don't get until later on, but that's much more marked with ADHD. Peers can be a struggle for kids with ADHD, not always, but often is. They can have more arguments, more falling outs, so the peer relationships can be much more volatile, the changing peer group. And that actually can be, like we touched on, a real source of distress for young people. They could have a really established peer group, suddenly that's gone. They just fall out, and then they don't have that contact anymore. And actually, that is quite distressing, which is why it is so commonly associated with depression. But also, they can pick a challenging peer group. You know, sometimes it's easier to fit in if you have ADHD with a peer group where they're also impulsive, they're also making bad choices, they're also roaming around and being active and getting involved in all sorts of things. And it's actually sometimes harder to fit in the more studious, calmer, sensible group because there's that difference. And sometimes with a challenging peer group, you can find that they sometimes then get involved in other things. So if there's a peer group that's using drugs, we sometimes find, unfortunately, young people with ADHD, they sometimes self-medicate, and so they will sometimes find that when they're using drugs, the ADHD symptoms are slightly less, so that then encourages them to do it more. But also there's that whole impulsivity. Someone offers you a smoke of something you shouldn't be smoking, and with ADHD you think, great, that sounds like a really good idea, because they don't necessarily think through the consequences. Relationships with ADHD, again, can be a bit of a challenge on both sides. It can. that impulsivity, you can really see that kind of second date declaring undying love, you are the one for me forever. And the person who's on the receiving end of that goes, this is only our second date. And it can be that real sort of mismatch sometimes. And that can be quite upsetting for particularly boys with ADHD, because they feel that they can't get a girlfriend. And it's probably not that they can't get a girlfriend, it's just that they're too forward too quick because of that impulsivity. So again, that kind of discussion with parents about, well, you know, how do you manage dating? When is it appropriate? What are the social rules about when do you declare undying affection to someone? When's that appropriate? When's that not appropriate? Can just help them to benchmark relationships? Because it's not one of those things you talk about quite often with your peer group, is when do you say to a girl that you love them? But where do you have that conversation if you're not going to talk about it with your friends? Often relationships, people with ADHD are quick to fall out, but quick to get back together. So it's a real yo-yo on-off relationships you quite often see. And sometimes you do see that their other half can struggle, particularly with that kind of the rapid mood swings. Where I've seen it work really well is when young people have been quite open about the fact they've got ADHD, and that the other half can kind of recognise it and go, oh, okay, that's just mood swings, rather than me doing something wrong or me putting my foot in it or you don't like me anymore. So they sort of have the context of what they're dealing with. Sex is important, particularly with ADHD. Again, you can sometimes, same thing we talked about with drugs, that young people with ADHD can sometimes self-medicate with drugs. They can also sometimes use sex as a way of kind of almost self-medicating. You know, sex can be soothing, you get that intimacy, you get that pleasure. And if you've not got that ability to soothe yourself in other areas, or you've not got that kind of place where you can improve your self-esteem, actually sometimes sex is a really good place to get it. They sometimes also think that it will improve their social standing, and that, unfortunately, sometimes you see girls with ADHD, in order to fit in, will sometimes use sexual relationships as a way of doing that. But even though they, you know, are perhaps more likely to be sexually active, they are less likely to make good choices, they're less likely to use safe sex. So lots of research, particularly focused on boys with ADHD, much less likely to use condoms, much less likely to use safe sex. So in terms of just sexual health in relationships, that's quite important to pick up on. And in my last CAMHS, we actually used to be part of the condom card scheme, which was great, because, you know, the boys with ADHD, and it was pretty much only the boys with ADHD, would come in with their card. We didn't have many teenagers that dropped out of the ADHD clinic. They would come in, not for their blood pressure and pulse, but they would come in for their condoms. It's a good way of engaging young people. So, really worth, as parents, if we're talking about relationships, if we're talking about safe sex, important for you guys to be thinking about contraception with your young people. So for girls, think about condoms, but also think about longer term protection in terms of pregnancy and things like that. And one of the things I think that causes young people with ADHD difficulties in terms of safe sex is remembering it. You know, if you think about, you know, for girls, your contraceptive pill, you have to remember to take that every single day. You have to have some sort of structure, some organisation, some ability to remember that that's something you've got to do. If you leave it to them, it's just not going to happen. There's a whole range of other contraceptive devices now that young people can access, and that is worth thinking about, just in terms of sort of longer term health, longer term prevention and protection. Always worth talking, having the condom talk. They would have had it at school, I'm sure, but do they know where to access them? Do they know how to access them? And again, using those kind of talks when you're talking about relationships, you know, whether you're watching soaps or there's another avenue to doing that, introducing the idea of safe sex as being part of how you have relationships. So it's not an add-on. Add-ons get forgotten, particularly when you've got ADHD. It's yet another thing to remember, and that's just not going to happen. But if it becomes part of, this is what you do to treat your girlfriend right, it becomes much more part of the norm. So those kind of things can be really helpful. There's a really good website. So this is the Richmond website. So when the slides are up, it'll be up there on the slide. But getting it on is the Richmond service for young people, particularly in terms of sexual health. So it's good for parents to be aware of that, so they can make sure that the young people know about it as well. Whereas parents, you have your own challenges, because you've got this young person with ADHD who's making all sorts of challenging choices and behaviours, and all that stuff is happening. And then if you do nothing, you're seen as condoning it and allowing it to happen and not being a good enough parent. If you jump on top of it, then that's just not going to work, because actually they've got ADHD and it's not as though they're choosing it. So you're in a bit of a bind, unfortunately. I think it's important that kids with ADHD are given the same opportunities as every other teenager to learn about boundaries, appropriate behaviour, because actually they've got ADHD, but they still need to learn how to fit in with society, and they need to do that, because that's how they're going to have a more fulfilling life. They're going to sort of progress, do their own thing, have fun, all that kind of stuff. So that's important that they have the opportunity to do that. So I would never say to anyone, they've got ADHD, therefore it's always going to be that way, you can't do anything back off, because I don't think that's helpful for the kid. They need to have the opportunity to learn, but you do need to give them the opportunity to learn in a slightly different way. Yeah. And
be more flexible.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's the thing that people find hard to get their head around. The fact that you're doing it in a different way isn't you condoning the behaviour, isn't you saying, well, they've got ADHD, therefore we need to do nothing. It's simply saying they've got ADHD, therefore we need to teach them, but we need to do it in a different way. With the police, I think that is an important one to pick up on, because unfortunately kids with ADHD are more likely to get arrested than their peer group. Really worth, as soon as you know, letting them know that they not only have ADHD, but also letting them know that they should be on medication. So when they are questioned, if they are questioned, the police are actually doing it in terms of getting the timing right, so they're doing it whilst they're on their medication. It's no good having the police interview a kid with ADHD when they're not on medication. And you don't necessarily want to be in a situation where, if it happens at night, you don't want them to stay in a cell longer in order to address it. So sometimes you just have to manage it and just deal with it there and then. But if it is during the day and it is during a time of medication, sometimes just telling the police your life will be easier if you interview them whilst they're on medication, and just helping them know that actually part of that is to make their job easier as well. And that's sometimes how you can get alongside them, but it's not always easy.
Somebody else talked earlier a little bit about with the anxiety and tics and Tourette's. Can we just sort of do 5 minutes on what tics are and how they might present? Would that be interesting?
Tics are an impulsive movement or vocalisation. So they can be sort of movements or sounds. You get a tic sensation building up quite often, particularly with Tourette's, where you feel the urge to do it. And then there's this sort of explosive behaviour that can be movements, can be noises. Very rare for it to be swearing. That would be really quite unusual. Whereas that's the stereotype of what Tourette's is. Actually, that's by no means the norm. The norm for Tourette's would be much more motor movements, sort of shrugging, grimaces, facial movements, body movements and twitches. But it's that there's a real sense of this sort of sudden explosive element to the tics. So it's not just a movement, you know, you're shrugging your shoulders, which there's a much more gradual physical process that goes on with that. It's a much more sudden explosive movement where suddenly they're moving, or suddenly they're kind of expressing something verbally. And the verbal tics can be noises, coughs, sniffs, quite common, animal noises, grunting noises, other noises are really quite common. Words, really rare. Swear words, even rarer. But it can happen. So that's tics, roughly, overall. There's a range of tics. The commonest is probably sort of anxiety-related, stress-related tics, which are reasonably common in childhood, that a young person going through an anxious situation can then develop tics as a part of that anxiety. And usually they're sort of fairly temporary. They might last 6 months, might last a couple of years, but they sort of phase out. really the treatment for that is trying to figure out what the anxiety source is and trying to resolve that, and that's usually the best way of doing it. Sometimes the young person, if the anxiety is quite severe, might need a specific piece of work to help them manage the anxiety. But those tics can happen to anyone. The Tourette's type tics, much more we'd see that as sort of a neurodevelopmental disorder in a similar way that you'd have ADHD and autism, so it's partly the way that your brain is wired as well. In terms of Tourette's, it's not that uncommon, because there's many aspects of Tourette's, it's not just the tics. Often people with Tourette's also have associated difficulties as well. They will often have ADHD, they will often have perhaps a degree of autistic spectrum, they will often have obsessive compulsive disorder or traits of that. They don't necessarily need to meet all the criteria for all the diagnoses, but you might see that they have features of one more than another, or features of all of them. So, and the different parts will sometimes kick in at different stages of their development. So you might actually see a young person having a diagnosis of ADHD, and it looks like ADHD, and to all intents and purposes is ADHD, and then they continue to grow and develop, and then they come to adolescence, and that's where the tics start to emerge. And tics for Tourette's often start to emerge sort of late childhood, early adolescence, and then peak at adolescence, and then for a large proportion they sort of start to wane and decrease around adolescence. So you can certainly see young people in an ADHD clinic, for example, where everyone thinks it's ADHD, and then the tics start to emerge, and you think, oh, I wonder if, and it could be actually this young person's actually got Tourette's, and it's just the ADHD became much more noticeable earlier on.
Can Tourette's develop later? Or does he have to be born with Tourette's?
No, well, so it's the thinking is that Tourette's is quite strongly genetic, and you are born with the tendency to have it, and that there's a certain amount of hardwiring that happens, so you've got that laid down, but how it expresses itself seems to be really quite complicated, and there seems to be this interaction with a number of things in your life and environment that can then bring on the onset of Tourette's as well. So it's one of those really...
It could be a trigger.
Not... Sometimes the trigger is something as simple and straightforward as a throat infection. And there's some things in the antibodies of throat infections, for example, that they can then trigger the tics. And so there's all sorts of funny things. So the genetics of it are really interesting, but really complicated and odd. So we don't know a huge amount other than the fact that there's so many different factors. It tends to follow a traditional pattern of tics in kind of middle childhood, late or early adolescence, peaking and then waning, with features of ADHD, ASD and OCD as a sort of satellite difficulty around it. That would be the norm. You can have late onset Tourette's even into adult life, but really quite rare and uncommon.
And very repetitive activity, would you see that as anxiety, a sort of avoidance thing, or a part of an autistic sort of side, or ADHD?
Yeah.
I could take a pick of all of those.
Sure. Yeah. The repetitiveness can, and it partly depends on what it is and how it shows itself, but you see that kind of repetitiveness quite common with autistic spectrum, you see it with OCD, you can see it to a certain degree with anxiety and various anxiety disorders. So yeah, there can be a range of things that can cause repetitive behaviours, but tics on the whole, they are often repetitive because you see the same movements, but they're not repetitive in that they're not always predictable. So whereas someone with ASD, their behaviours will be much more predictable, and with OCD, very predictable. With Tourette's, they are much less predictable. They notice they're going to tick a couple of seconds before, and it comes. But it can come, you can have three in a row, and then nothing for 5 minutes, and then you can have one regularly for another 5 minutes, and then nothing. So it's much less predictable.
I've heard... sort of with grapevine that there is sort of like a ticking season, and it's like the first term is the worst.
Okay, sure.
And summer term is a bit less pressure in school. So is it related more to
anxiety? I would expect then that would be the anxiety tics,
not
which are
really
quite common. Not Tourette's so much.
No.
Well, yes and no. Tourette, I mean, certainly the anxiety-related tics, you're going to notice any sort of seasonal pattern. As I said, with CAMHS, CAMHS is quite seasonal in terms of the kind of the peaks and troughs during the year, because partly because of school, yeah, the school term is different and the demands are different through the school year. So what kids are exposed to changes as you go. So if you've got someone who's prone to the anxiety-type tics, you know, the September term, you can imagine going into a new class, getting to know a new teacher, the whole, and sometimes going up a year, you've got higher expectations. You know, there's a lot of anxiety and stress in that term. So you probably would see more of the anxiety-related tics. With Tourette's, you might have a constant tic disorder that happens during the summer, during any term, but you will notice at times of stress that increasing. So there's definitely an anxiety-related component to it. And sometimes that is, you know, there's all sorts of different treatments that are emerging, but sometimes just working with the anxiety for people with Tourette's can just reduce those peaks and drops.